Good morning. Welcome to the second meeting of 2016 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones, etc., as they may affect the broadcasting system. However, you may notice some committee members consulting tablets during the meeting. This is because we have provided meeting papers digitally. We have apologies today from Maurice Golden. We've been joined by Peter Chapman, MSP, who are welcome to the meeting. Moving to agenda item one, which is the decision on taking business in private. What we're to consider is taking item four in private later today. Are we agreed to that?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Agenda item two, declaration of interest. The second item is to invite Alexander Burnett to declare any interests he may have that are relevant to the work of the committee, and I invite Alexander Burnett to declare his interests.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to make a declaration of my registrable interests. I own and manage property, including agricultural, residential and commercial lettings, recreational and sporting usage and forestry. I also own shares in a renewable energy company, and I hold remunerated positions in companies related to these matters.
Thank you very much, and welcome to the committee. We've also, as I said, been joined by Peter Chapman this morning, and I offer Peter Chapman the opportunity to also declare any interests that he may have.
Thank you, convener. I'm a partner in P. Chapman & Co., which is a farming business, and I'm also a director of Red Bog Renewables, which is a business that has wind turbines. I'm a member of NFUS. I'm a director of the Aberdeen Northern March Group, and it's all in the appropriate register.
Okay. Thank you very much, and welcome to today's meeting. The third,
convener, I checked with the clerks before the meeting started, and just for clarification, since the last meeting, I have been made deputy convener of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, so I just wanted to put that on the record.
Okay, thank you. Well, that's on the record. Thank you. Okay, moving to agenda item three, which is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform. Welcome the Cabinet Secretary and her officials. In addition to Ms Cunningham, we have John Ireland, Deputy Director of Low Carbon Economy Division, and Keith Connell, the Deputy Director of Natural Resources for the Scottish Government. At the outset, I have to say that we have a great deal of ground to cover, and it may not be possible to deal with everything in detail. So we may well write to you, Cabinet Secretary, seeking further detail, or indeed with fresh questions that we haven't reached today. Similarly, please do feel free to indicate in the course of the evidence session whether there are areas that you would feel the need to perhaps write back to us yourself. Kicking off, Cabinet Secretary, I think since we extended the invitation to meet with us today, there have been rather significant developments in the shape of the EU referendum result, which threatened to have considerable effect on your portfolio. I think even a cursory glance at your enormous remit suggests few other portfolios are potentially going to be as impacted upon. Climate change, emission targets delivery, EU bird and habitat directives, possible infraction proceedings, SRDP funding for environmental schemes, MPAs, beavers. I think those are just some of the things which spring to mind. So perhaps could you outline at the outset, if only to avoid the implications of the referendum outcome possibly dominating all the questions that are to come, how the government is assessing or will assess the potential effect of Brexit on your areas of responsibility, and to what extent these might impact on the government's legislative programme?
I think the last week puts everything in this portfolio into a slightly different light, because this portfolio and possibly the rural economy portfolio are the two most heavily impacted by the EU in every way, and that therefore means that just about every aspect of what we do would have to be seen against that backdrop now. However, our starting point here is basically got to be that the best way of solving anything other than very local environmental issues is for cooperation across national boundaries, and that solutions need to be developed across a common framework. Now, whatever shape that forms, it doesn't change that a fundamental necessity. The European Union has been the mechanism by which that has been done. It's provided strategic policy direction for environmental measures and for many of the laws passed by this Parliament. Those laws protecting the environment have been within the framework of EU legislation. Last week's referendum doesn't actually change the force of our domestic law in which regulation and protection are embedded. So that's not going to change. So our regulatory bodies will continue to regulate and protect us. So SEPA, SNH, etc. will continue to do what they need to do in order to effect the outcomes that we consider to be necessary. And as a Cabinet Secretary, I'm going to continue to work across government to take forward important policy and legislation that gives effect to that. I suppose we're in the very early stages of having to try and map through all of the different impacts in the very different policy areas that there are. And to try and assess how quickly some of the impacts might be felt. I think, and that's a big unknown for us. For example, Convener, you mentioned the issue of the SRDP, the structural funds, the enormous extent to which organisations and our environment benefit from money directly coming from the EU. We just don't know what the future of that now is going to be. So there are certain uncertainties that are, for us, at the moment, not easy to calculate. However, understanding our exposure is going to be important, and that's work that we will have to do across not just my portfolio, but across government. But of course, we remain within the EU, and therefore the EU rules continue to apply. We have EU obligations which continue to apply, and we can't simply behave now as if they don't exist because we remain within the EU, and the timescale for that is uncertain and looks like it may continue to be uncertain for quite a while. I can't preempt what the First Minister is going to say in a statement this afternoon, and I know there's a debate in the Chamber this afternoon, so a lot of these sort of general issues will probably come up, but we've got to look at the focus as being twofold. We've got to govern competently and continue to do so. And secondly, we have to protect Scotland's interests and our place in the EU. Now, that's something for government as a whole, but it's also something for each Cabinet Secretary within their portfolios to consider too. We're in uncharted territory, and a lot of questions we're not going to have answers to, and that may, I regret, have to be my response this morning, that there are questions I simply cannot answer. But I would give you this reassurance that we are going to be doing our absolute utmost to protect our position as climate change leader, to continue to play the role that we have been playing in contributing to EU-wide environment policy, to make sure that we're maintaining, protecting and advancing our own environment. I think that we can get through this, but to pretend that it's going to be simple and straightforward, I think would be to mislead everybody.
Dave Stewart would like to come in with a quick question.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with the Cabinet Secretary when she states that we're in an uncharted territory here. Clearly, we do know some information. We know that the Article 50, when it's put forward, can only be put forward by the member state that's leaving, that apart from Greenland, no other country has ever left the EU. And we do know that there is a two-year timetable to negotiate during that period. In my experience, if you look at countries like Canada, getting trade deals done within a two-year period is extremely difficult. Do you have real worries about the timetable once it is lodged with the European President?
Well, I mean, at the moment, I'd have to say that along with everybody else, my concerns are about what the timetable is actually going to be. I've heard one prominent individual stating categorically that they thought 1st January 2019 was the clear date for actually leaving, i.e. Article 50 being triggered as at 1st January 2017. I'm now listening to radio reports of other views that would suggest that Article 50, they could somehow not trigger it until around about 2020 or thereabouts. Yes, convener, you obviously didn't have time to hear Jeremy Hunt on the radio this morning. The former position was Liam Fox. I think the difficulty is at the moment there is absolutely nothing that we can assess with certainty. Now, I mean, obviously, if Article 50 is triggered and we're talking about somewhere in the foreseeable future, we're looking at a very different set of circumstances compared to a situation where they might be talking about triggering an Article 50 not until 2020. Those two scenarios present us with utterly and completely different ways of proceeding. And at the moment, the difficulties that presents is quite significant. With respect to trade agreements, well, that's not my portfolio. I would imagine that there are significant issues with trade agreements, but I suspect with a great deal more than just trade agreements.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just to wrap this part of it up, you're absolutely, it's understandable what you're talking about, requiring time to map this through, but could I ask for an undertaking on behalf of the committee that as that mapping through, that figuring out the impact on your portfolio takes place, that you and your officials will undertake to keep us appraised of the progress and the information that's gleaned through that, because it might well be that we as a committee feel it appropriate to explore some of these issues ourselves.
I'm happy to keep the committee up to date with our thinking as it okay. proceeds.
Okay.
None of us will have a monopoly on wisdom in this respect.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll move on to the sort of general areas of question. We're going to start with climate change. Mark Roscoe, I'm just going to lead on that.
Yeah, convener, I just had a brief follow-up question in relation to Brexit. I mean, we woke up on Friday morning, see the price of the pound, dropping against the dollar.
You for managing to get some sleep to wake up from. I'm afraid I didn't.
an hour or two it was. But we also saw the carbon price across Europe dip considerably. I think it dropped by 15% on Friday morning. That obviously impacts on the ability of the EU emissions trading scheme to continue to cut carbon from major emitters across Europe. I'm just wondering, what consideration can you give right now to Scotland's continuation, either within the EU ETS going forward, which of course will have an impact on Scotland's climate target, or indeed other options, which may be having a separate scheme or carbon tax or whatever?
That is a question that's probably too soon for us to really be able to answer. It is nevertheless something that we will have to look at very, very carefully, particularly given this coming year, particularly given the Manifesto Commitment for Another Climate Change Act. There's a whole set of new conversations that really arise out of that. And I noticed in the bygoing that the rapporteur on EU trading scheme, Ian Duncan MEP, has stepped down from his position. So there now isn't anybody doing that job either. So I suspect right now those answers are not available anywhere. That is the kind of thing that we will come back to the committee on when we have a better handle on how that might impact on what we're doing.
Okay. And as you say, it obviously then plays into the forthcoming climate bill. So can I then turn to that climate bill? We have an action plan, an existing action plan on climate change. We have a new action plan that will be developed, presumably with stakeholders and with a newly reconvened cabinet subcommittee on climate change, hopefully involving all government ministers, so we have policy coherency across all directorates within the Scottish Government. What's the timescale for that? What's going to come first, the action plan or the target? Because obviously we're in a great position now in Scotland to go beyond the targets that we've got. I know that's the aspiration of the Scottish Government. We've got areas that we can work on, particularly around transport and housing, where we can make substantial progress. So what's the timescale? And I think there's an issue that, as a committee, we're particularly interested in, convener, around, how do we scrutinise this coming forward? Clearly, there's an action plan, a set of actions, and a target. How do the two dovetail together, and what can we expect in terms of timescales there?
Well, I can't speak to a timescale for legislation. That's something that the First Minister will make clear when she delivers a programme for government, and I can't preempt any decisions that she might take about when that legislation may take place. There is a commitment to legislate. So I think, from my perspective, we simply have to proceed with the actions that flow from the existing climate change legislation, and we have to press ahead with those in the immediate and foreseeable future. And that is what we're intending to do. I'm opening up discussions and conversations with the Committee on Climate Change already, and that is how we will inform ourselves as to what it is we choose to do. But we're going to do that on the timescales that are laid down by the previous Climate Change Act, rather than try and preempt what might or might not happen in terms of a future Climate Change Act, which, as I said, at this stage, I can't actually say the timescale for. We've got RPP3, obviously. Now, we've made a commitment that that will be laid by December 2016, although that's what we're working on so far. So you'll see that quite soon. And that draft, as I said, will come before Parliament and the committee in December. So there's a kind of very specific bit of the timetable locked into place, although we'll keep that under review, because some of the issues that we're already discussing this morning might begin to impact on some of the things that has to look at. As I indicated, we're already in conversation with the UK Committee on Climate Change as to how we might proceed on that basis. We're looking to begin to look at the changing targets, again, arising out of the existing climate change bill. And I think the idea is that somewhere around about the autumn, we'll begin to have some concrete thinking around that. Again, at that point, the committee would be likely to be involved in those. That's slightly different. Mm-hmm. So you've probably got two timescales there. You've got the changing of the interim annual targets would probably be about autumn, and then the RPP3 draft by winter, December at the moment, but as I said, we'll keep that under review, and then a climate change bill sometime further down the line. That's how we're kind of working at the moment.
And in terms of the scope of the bill as well, I mean, you know, globally scientists are telling us that we need to keep 4/5 of our known fossil fuel reserves in the ground. We've obviously got a whole range of currently uncharacterized resources, including shale gas in the UK, which could cause quite a significant impact in terms of climate change if we were to exploit them. I mean, will the bill be dealing with any of these issues? I mean, a lot of...
drafted yet. So at the moment, the scope RPP3. And extent of the bill is not yet clear. From the perspective of where we were, the principal driver was to raise the emissions target, the interim target. So that probably helps an understanding of a broader timescale, because the interim target is to be hit by 2020. If we're wanting to raise that, we have to do so in reasonable time. But the extent and the detail of the bill has not yet been finalised.
Mm-hmm. But will RPP, for example, examine and look at the actions that will be needed, for example, to restrict shale gas in Scotland if the Scottish Government's research into shale gas...
I really don't want to get drawn into a debate about fracking, since that is not in my portfolio remit. Clearly, there will be consideration of all these things throughout RPP3 and throughout the legislation as well.
Right. Okay.
Leah Beamish.
Right. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Could I just ask you, just as a follow-up question, in relation to the Climate Change Bill and the RPP3, if how they dovetail together, really, because if the Climate Change Bill introduces any significant changes in terms of our emissions reduction targets, would it be that we would have to be then looking at the RPP3 again if it's already been sort of sewn together?
Well, look, we have an obligation under the existing legislation to do RPP3 within the more immediate timescale. Now, we're not going to not fulfil that obligation because we've promised another Climate Change Act. So RPP3 will go through. There will then be climate change legislation. Might that mean some reconsideration of the decisions that were, taken, the way the RPP3 is dealt with? Then I suppose I can't rule that out. But I don't want to. I mean, the obvious logic there would be not to do RPP3 until we'd legislated, and I don't think anybody would want that to happen either. So really the only way we can do is to proceed as if this other legislation wasn't happening, just fulfil our obligations, and then the climate change legislation will be an opportunity to reconsider how we think that might work. And, if that means making some changes, then I think that's how we have to live with it. But it's the right thing to do, I think, to have the climate change legislation. But I think it's also the right thing to do to fulfil our obligations under the existing Act.
Right, thank you. And could I ask you if you're considering any specific steps to address emissions in sectors such as transport where they have fallen least?
That is going to be one of the things that the Cabinet Subcommittee will need to discuss. I'm responsible for setting the overall policy, but then there are other portfolios that will have to actually carry all that out. So that discussion is one of the discussions that we will need to take. And in fact, I've already had a brief conversation with the Transport Minister about the sectoral issues that arise out of our recent targets. So you can rest assured that I'm conscious of the vastly different contribution different sectors are making to our progress.
Thank you, that's reassuring. And also reassuring, if I may say so, is the fact that the subcommittee is reconvened. Could I just ask you, having been on the Public Sector Climate Leaders Forum, what the plans are to support the public sector going forward in relation to climate change, and also the wider question of the support across society for behaviour change?
Well, I mean, obviously, behaviour change across society is kind of pretty key to making real progress. I mean, some of the sectoral areas in which we made a great deal of progress are probably because of the cumulative effect of a lot of relatively small changes. And it's an argument that's always been made. It doesn't rule out the necessity to make some bigger changes, but bringing people along is fundamental to all of this, and we do continue to engage across the board on that. People may remember the campaigning to get people to switch down their central heating and all the rest of it, which of course had the twin effect of saving them money as well as reducing emissions. So we have to continue to work at that level. Some of the areas that we will need to make some real progress in might be harder. I'm not going to run away from the challenge of persuading people that they shouldn't be having just constant and immediate resort to their cars. That's a harder argument to make with individuals who are very keen on the broad approach but less keen when it actually comes to them personally. There are areas in which I suspect the message might be a little bit more difficult to get across, but get it across we must. That will be part of what we take going forward. Obviously public sector action on climate change is driven by public duties that were laid down in the 2009 Act, and that's the all of the things like mandatory reporting, which you know, which is part of it, the support that's needed in order to do that across public bodies. We support a raft of other services as well, from which the public sector can access support and advice. You know, members will be aware of organisations like Energy Savings Trust, etc. These are the ones put in place to help. You know, it is the responsibility of the whole of the public sector to take effective action. I think that what we've done now is to ask the Scottish Leader Forum to take oversight on climate change action in the public sector. So we're not taking our eye off that ball. I mean, obviously, in some of the sectoral areas that we need to make further progress, there's a huge issue for the private sector as well, which is takes a deal of engagement and has to be worked through very carefully. And if I may be permitted one reference to the current scenario we now find ourselves in, of course, the uncertainty that is out there across business and the private sector will be something that we have to work with when we're trying to persuade them of some of the actions that we want them to take in this regard as well.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Right, thank you. Moving on to look at the circular economy, Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In the previous session, the former RACI committee did some work on the circular economy. And of course, the SNP manifesto details proposals to include a circular economy and zero waste bill. So, could you give the committee some detail on what you plan to include in the bill, and when you plan to bring forward further details regarding the legislative proposals?
Well, my default position on legislative proposals will be that it's not my decision; it's the First Minister's decision, and I can't preempt the First Minister, other than to obviously remind the committee that there is a commitment to have legislation in this regard. I have officials who are currently working on aspects of the circular economy in any case, because there are other initiatives that relate to this. And there are questions over what might or might not appear in a piece of legislation. So, you know, there are a number of things that in theory could, but whether or not you would necessarily want to move straight to legislation in some of them is another question. So we've got to make a judgment call on that in terms of balancing, you know, what we want to continue to do on a partnership basis and what we think we need to move to legislate on. There haven't been any final decisions.
Okay, thanks. Taking that response on board, could I maybe turn to deposit return schemes?
Yes.
The committee has indicated an early interest in this session in deposit return schemes, and I was pleased to host in the previous session, just before Parliament was dissolved, a roundtable discussion on the issue. And I've seen it firsthand, the progress of such schemes in Norway and other Nordic nations since the mid-80s, and have followed its progress over the past three decades. So I think it's fair to say that we're a wee bit behind when it comes to deposit return schemes. Now, I'm aware of strong lobbying on both sides of the argument, so I was curious as to what plans the Scottish Government have to consider the introduction of deposit return schemes, and what are the challenges and opportunities to roll out such schemes in Scotland?
Well, we will be continuing to explore this area. As you've flagged up, there is by no means unanimity out there as to whether or not these would, you know, schemes such as these would be practicable and proportionate. But it is an area that we want to continue to consider. So in that sense, I will be picking up where the previous Cabinet Secretary left off. At present, Zero Waste Scotland are exploring the issues around that. And there were a number of things raised in the call for evidence last year, so that we do have to work through some of these areas so that we can fully understand the issues around the various schemes. And we do take on board that they're commonplace elsewhere. So some of the solutions arguably have already been found. But I think we also have to keep in mind the challenges that might be faced, particularly by smaller retailers, in all of this, so that the any consideration of such schemes would need to take all of that into account. So at present, the discussions continue. No scheme has been proposed, but nothing has yet been ruled out. So,
thank you.
Thank you. Finally, Carson.
Will there be any consideration of waste prevention or reuse targets or a new circular economy metric which is applicable to councils? Because as we all know that just recycling targets don't actually tell the whole picture.
And I mean, one of the key issues arising out of the last bit of conversation is, of course, that local authorities will have a very singular role in all of what we do. I think, as everybody knows, we've been, you know, pushing our household recycling charter. It's a voluntary initiative, and this goes back to what I said about whether or not everything has to be legislated for. How far can we take things on a voluntary basis? That is working through the system at the moment. Recycling rates can be improved hugely by making it a lot easier for people to recycle. And I've got some very, you know, specific concerns that I've flagged up myself in the past, that a lot of the kind of recycling stuff will, you know, all the waste banks and the community recycling presupposes folk have got cars in which to put their waste to drive it to these central depots. So, you know, there are kind of issues around how that is managed that I think we can do better than we currently do. So, and I'm sure that there are all sorts of examples around this table of other kinds of issues that arise. You know, we're trying to move forward with as much agreement as possible to try and it goes back to the engagement that Claudia Beamish mentioned, the need to actually bring people along with us in all of this. We are intending to bring in a food waste target as well, which will again impact on not just businesses but households. So all of this takes a great deal of discussion, thought, and careful consideration. Again, I would expect the committee to be involved in all of that.
Fine. Yeah. Happy with that. Right. Thanks. We move on, Cabinet Secretary. We're jumping about here, I realise, but there's some important areas that we need to cover. Can we just touch on the situation with the Crown Estate? And can you update us on where we're at in terms of the transfer scheme and then also perhaps looking to the longer term? Because obviously there is a process to be gone through here. So, for example, can we as a committee expect to see secondary legislation coming before us before too long?
Well, in fact, there's some movement already, convener. I think we are on the verge of moving forward with the necessary subordinate legislation to set in place the landing pad for the initial devolution. The difficulty with all of this is that we obviously want to have a longer-term consultation about what shape the Crown Estate will take once it is devolved. But the devolution will take place before 1st of April 2017. So there has to be a place for the initial responsibility to land. That requires us to have a shorter consultation around that interim body to allow that initial devolution to take place. The plan is then that we have space and time to have the longer consultation to allow us to then develop within Scotland the shape that the new Crown Estate will take.
thing. Can I ask what account's being taken of the fact this is quite an unsettling process for the staff at the Crown Estate, very valuable staff. So has there been dialogue with them? Are they being kept up to date about how this is all going to shake down?
Yes, we're conscious that the existing staff might be feeling very insecure about this, so we're taking steps to reassure them about the steps that we are taking, how this process will play out, what the potential timescales are. My understanding is that the staff are up for the challenge. It might be challenging for them, but it's also exciting for them because it gives them a whole new way to look at things. And I don't think we want to minimise the fact that many of them may welcome this this development and be looking forward to the conversation about what the Crown Estate will look like in Scotland once the longer-term decisions have been made.
Okay, thank you. And looking to those longer-term decisions and the implications, Dave Stewart wants to come in.
Convener, I think you're right to say, Cabinet Secretary, this is an exciting devolution, particularly, I think, for the island authorities. I've had quite extensive discussions with the conveners from three island authorities affected, and I think it's fair to say they're very enthusiastic about islands, our future. Will there be specific consultation for the islands authorities around the devolution of the Crown Estates?
Well, they will be consultees, clearly, because no final decisions have been made about the shape. That conversation has got to be had. I'm conscious that in different parts of Scotland there might be different views about how it might look. So we need to allow space for all of those voices to be heard and not rush it, which I think is quite important as well. We've got a job to do in the short term, and we're tied to a Westminster timetable for this shorter term for the actual legal devolution to take place. So we've got to get through that process. What I would quite like is if people accept that this interim solution is just got to be dealt with in a relatively speedy way from our perspective, and it's dictated by a Westminster timetable, and then we've got the bigger and better and longer consultation, which will allow all the voices to be heard in respect of how the Crown Estate will look in the rest of Scotland. So, I'll be meeting with the stakeholder advisory group during the summer, and we'll take that forward on that. So, I suppose there might be statutory instruments that will begin to appear at the committee over the next period. Keith, we're not quite sure about that. But anything that appears within the next year will probably relate to the interim process. It won't be relevant to the longer term process.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to flood prevention, and again, Dave Stewart has some questions around that.
Thank you, convener. Clearly, flooding's a vitally important issue and a real concern as a byproduct of climate change. What lessons, if any, have the government learned from the flooding that occurred both in December and January? Is there issues that the government are revising its strategy following?
Well, yes, whenever serious flood events do occur, what's vital is that they're investigated and lessons are learned in order to provide us with information about future flood mitigation measures particularly for those particular areas. I think it was reassuring that the flood defences did stand up to the tests in December, early January, and that the National Flood Risk Assessment published in 2011, not quite sure, had correctly identified the majority areas that were vulnerable. This is a kind of part of the process, of course, though, which is, we can do the best forecasting we can in terms of identifying vulnerable areas. But as time goes by, sometimes areas that that hadn't been previously foreseen as vulnerable do become vulnerable, and that poses a big challenge for everybody. I know that some places were more severely affected than might have been anticipated, while they were perhaps foreseen as being vulnerable. The extent of that vulnerability had maybe not been understood, but that's part and parcel of kind of what I've just said, that this is not an exact science because you're forecasting, and we can only do the best we can. There was an area in Dumfries and Galloway which flooded far more severely than perhaps had been foreseen. That's, again, the lessons from that have to be taken forward into everything that we do after that. So every time there's a severe flooding event, that does go into consideration of how we forecast for the future.
Karina, could I ask a wider question to the Cabinet Secretary? I take the point that the Cabinet Secretary is not responsible for house building and for planning. But in terms of corporate planning, there is building currently on floodplains in Scotland. You may be aware of a petition that came in the last session, which argued that if there's flooding on a housing development in the floodplain, then the local authority may be liable, as will the house builder. Now, in fairness, the Petitions Committee didn't resolve the legalities of that point. But the point I'm making is, if there's building on floodplains, clearly that causes huge issues for potential damage. And I've experienced that in my own patch in Inverness, where a whole estate was flooded, partly because it was a floodplain and there wasn't sufficient flood prevention measures integrated. Have you had discussions with your ministerial colleagues who are responsible for planning about this very issue?
Not that very specific issue, but I'm having considerable numbers of discussions with many of my colleagues across a range of issues, and this will be one that I will discuss with the planning minister. Of course, the irony is that huge parts of urban Scotland are indeed built on floodplains because they were built on floodplains 1,000 years ago, and we've just stayed where we are. And, you know, we have had to learn to deal with that. Going forward, yes, you need to look at future developments. I can understand the other side of the argument, of course, though, is that the extent to which you then rule out of potential development all sorts of areas that would otherwise be necessary for house building, and we have a target for house building too. So, you know, there are issues here about how you build in prevention and mitigation at the same time, and you've got to take a balanced view of all of that. The extent to which perhaps decisions have been made which have turned out not to be the best ones, again, that will be part and parcel of our, you know, the way we look at things going forward. And those are conversations that I will want to have.
Convener, so you, I was reading just before the committee that that there's around 200,000 Scots who are at risk of flooding because of pluvial flooding, surface flooding in Scotland, around 2 million in the UK. I mean, do you recognise the scale of the problem in terms of that figure?
Well, of course I do. And my concern is that as time goes past, you know, that figure may increase simply because our understanding of what impacts are being made on the climate will become clearer as well. So we're, they're right across the board. This is something that has to be kept under consideration, must become part of our explanation of why some of the actions that we're taking in other regards are being taken. People have to marry the two. Mm. People have to understand that the consequences of not doing things in one area will potentially be problems in other areas.
And two quick comments, because I'm conscious of time, convener. Do you recognise also the important role that farmers and land managers have
Sure.
in flood prevention,
Yeah.
for example, in forestry, the development of flood banks? How important is mitigation?
I think that land managers are probably themselves very well aware of the important role. I mean, I know simply from my own local circumstances that farmers are well accustomed to effectively providing, you know, fields for flooding when rivers rise, and I'm certain other members are in that same position, and they will know those areas which are, you know, disappear underwater when there are significant events. So working directly with rural land managers is extremely important. But it is back to that conversation that we need to have both with them and with the surrounding communities about the when they see something changing in terms of being preparing for these events, that they mustn't just see these as negative issues, that they've got to actually look at the consequences of not doing it in the future. People often don't bring those two bits of the calculation together.
Thank you. Camina, the final question, I don't expect the Minister to have an answer to this, but she will recall my interest in the Met Office, who, as the Cabinet Secretary knows, have a system of high-density radar throughout Scotland.
I know where we're going with this.
there is a real problem with the particular Highlands. Parts of Scotland, yes. Particularly Moray, which members will know have a high risk of flooding. High-density radar predicts bad weather patterns. Mm. I know, and I've previously raised this, that this is, of course, an issue for the Met Office. But if we wrote to the Cabinet Secretary, could the Cabinet Secretary raise this again
yes.
with the Met Office? Because clearly prevention is better than cure.
Yes.
And I'm very concerned that England has 100% coverage and Scotland doesn't.
Yeah, I'm picking up the reins after a five-year gap in this portfolio, and sadly, some things haven't changed.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Peter Chapman's got a brief supplementary.
A brief supplementary, yes. Cabinet Secretary, have you had any discussions with SEPA since we're speaking about farmers and managing the courses of rivers? There's been a considerable build-up of gravel banks over the years, and SEPA is very reluctant to allow farmers to remove these obstructions, and they can create real problems, and the, you know, the obstruction themselves will create the issue that rivers overflow their banks, and therefore the flooding is made worse. But SEPA are very reluctant to allow farmers to do some of this essential work on the water courses around that flow through their land.
Could. Yes. Oh, I'm just being advised. I was about to say that's another thing that hasn't changed farmers' desire for the ability to effectively dredge the rivers in their area. But I'm being advised by Keith, and he might want to say something about this, that after the recent events, SEPA has in fact advised farmers that they can do so without seeking further advice.
I understand,
which is news to me.
I understand that SEPA issued some guidance in relation to the recent flooding, and their door is always open. I think they've had quite a constructive approach to engaging with the farming community over the last few years.
Mm. I think, in fairness to SEPA, they've sometimes taken the view that there can be a simplistic notion that this will work, when in SEPA's view that isn't always necessarily the case, and that in some cases it can actually make things worse. So it isn't just the easy straightforward solution that I think, you know, has been, because after all, the events that we're now seeing are significantly greater than they would have been in the past as well, so that the notion that simply dredging will be enough isn't necessarily the case.
Conscious of time, we do move on. Emma Harper has a supplementary around SEPA as well.
I think you've probably answered the question already, but it's just to clarify that areas that have been identified as potential vulnerable areas, they get Scottish Government funding, and then there's other areas that are not previously identified that have been flooded recently, especially in my area of Dumfries and Galloway. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree that we need to review these areas not previously identified as flooding and incorporate them into the future?
Well, I mean, we keep these things under review all the time, and that is one of the difficulties, because while we can all have 2020, you know, hindsight vision when it comes to looking to the future, we're all of us slightly imperfect in how we see things developing. We can only do the best we can in terms of forecasting, and that forecasting is constantly under review and has to be for exactly the reason you're talking about.
Darshan.
Back of that, we've had communities, and I'm glad you're aware of them, in Dumfries and Galloway, where one village in particular has been flooded three times in the last 2 years. And there's circumstantial evidence that that's down to clear felling and changing land use roundabout. Is there any plans to bring forward some sort of funding to help these communities that are not being identified through SEEP or whatever, just to give these communities some reassurance? Because in the likes of Cairnsfern, we had 29 out of 32 houses flooded three times, as I say, in a two-year period. And they're looking for some assurance that the government appreciates that it's not all about economics. It's actually, there's a huge social impact in rural communities that are not covered by the existing schemes.
I've got every sympathy with communities that suffer repeat flooding. I have some in my own constituency as well who unfortunately suffer repeat flooding too. I'm aware that there has been bad impacts in a number of occasions over the last few years in the members' constituency. The legislation doesn't prevent a council undertaking works out with a potentially vulnerable area. That's perhaps a potential answer to the previous question as well. There is an updated flood study, I understand, being undertaken by the council, which ultimately might lead to a flood protection scheme for the village. But obviously a case for that has to be made, and then that then becomes an issue of balancing what will be interests that aren't so keen with those that are. There is and will always be a continuing need to target resources at those areas most at risk. We don't have a get-out-of-jail-free card in respect of an unlimited amount of money to spend everywhere as and when. So we are constantly looking at and revising those areas that are most at risk so we can make sure that the bulk of the resources are targeted directly to those. But my understanding of, for example, the recent round is that while there is a skewing towards those areas most at risk, that isn't to say that there isn't money that is available to all the other local authorities as well, even those ones without currently areas at risk. So we're not cutting off funding from anywhere, but we are having to rebalance it, to be fair. I think Dumfries and Galloway Council will be getting funding for a number of flood protection schemes as part of the whole process. So, I mean, perhaps the member will want to continue in direct communication with me on his specific constituency concerns.
We'll take you up on that offer. Mark Ruskell to complete this section.
Just very briefly, and following on from that point, I'm just wondering how discussions are progressing with COSLA on a lot of these issues, because what I'm seeing in the local authorities is significant capacity issues in terms of staffing, inability perhaps to bring forward capital projects, and of course, you know, a challenging settlement for local government as well in terms of its ability to enhance capital programmes to fill the gap that perhaps Scottish Government is unable to fill.
Well, I mean, a challenging settlement for everybody, including Scottish Government. So, you know, we are in the business of trying to make those decisions about where the risk is greatest and take decisions accordingly. We have agreed with COSLA that funding of £42 million per year is to be available, and the funding round that Emma Harper referred to is one that is agreed with COSLA, and that distribution has been agreed with COSLA. So that provides some source of capacity support and financial backing for what might need to be done. There are flood risk management strategies already published, and the local authority plans are now published, I think, as of last Wednesday, Thursday.
Yeah, they've been published.
It's just in the events of last Thursday, they perhaps went unnoticed. so if people hadn't actually picked up that they'd been published, they may want to go and look at what has been decided in respect of their own local areas and take that on board. As I indicated, local authorities can allocate additional resources. I appreciate that then becomes a question of, well, what do you take it away from? But I'm afraid the Scottish Government's in no different a position. If we are to allocate more resources to one area, something else has to give. And these are not easy decisions for anybody to make.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll move on to land reform. We're obviously anticipating a raft of secondary legislation relating to the Land Reform Act. Does the government as yet have even a rough timetable of when the various aspects of this will come forward?
Right. Basically, there are a couple of timetables that are mandated almost by the legislation. So the Land Commission, for example, requires to be up and running by the 1st of April 2017, which, I'm kind of looking in the wrong direction for officials. So in order for that to be achieved, certain actions have got to be undertaken now. I expect the committee can anticipate having to have conversations about the Land Commission in and around the autumn. That wouldn't be an unfair prediction for you. That's one aspect. There's the Rights and Responsibilities Statement, which we want to pretty much dovetail with the Land Commission. We want to kind of keep all of this roughly together. So the conversations about that, you need to be thinking about that as well. And obviously, looking at the land use strategy at the same time. So I would anticipate for the committee's kind of workload that perhaps round about the autumn, issues to do with land reform will begin to appear back on your agenda. In terms of the actual precise timetable for any aspects of any bits of subordinate legislation, I can't give you an exact answer to that, but you can work back from the 1st of April to begin to see how that might look. Some of it, and I'm not sure if it's clear yet, I think the Part 10 stuff will go to the other committee. So that will be go to the other committee, not this one. So the Rights and Responsibilities Statement, the Land Commission, and the Land Use Strategy. Land Use Strategy will probably be both committees, but the Agricultural Holdings, etc., will be the other committee. I don't know if that helps a bit.
Okay. And can I ask, the plans for the consultation and the Register of Control and Interests, I think that's up and running, or it's about to start. So when would you envisage that the register likely to be in place?
What do we think the register is going to be in place?
The first action is going to be the consultation, mm-hmm. which will be issued this summer. And I think at this stage we're not committing to when the register finally would be in place. Mm-hmm. I mean, as the committee will recall, there are a number of quite complex legal issues associated with that register. But there was a clear commitment given. Mm-hmm. by the government to commence a consultation in the summer, and that is in hand.
So would it be fair, Cabinet Secretary, to speculate that perhaps 2 years from now we may still be dealing with the secondary legislation around the Land Reform Act?
I don't think you need to speculate. I think that will probably be the case.
Right, that's useful to know. I think Alexander Burnett's got a question he wants to bring in around the Commission.
Thank you, Convener. It's just really about the process for appointing land commissioners. And just to ask if it will follow the public appointments process regulated by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland, and in particular follow the principles in the Code of Practice for ministerial appointments to public bodies in Scotland. And this is really just to ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm the assurances that were given in Stage 2 of the Bill by the Minister.
I think the process of beginning appointments is going to be quite soon. We need to get people in place so that when we get to the 1st of April, it can be up and running. And we would we would plan on populating the Land Commission by.
In order to have the Commission up and running by April next year,
the
commitment was to have commissioners appointed by the end of the calendar year this year. It's quite a tight timetable, but we're on the verge of commencing that activity in the public domain to appoint commissioners by the end of the year.
The kind of detailed involvement of the committee in all of this, we're probably not really going to be able to confirm it until after the summer recess, because we've got to have a lot of conversation with parliamentary officials about this as well?
The question wasn't so much about the timing as would it follow the process set down by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. My recollection is that the commitment at the time was that the Parliament would be involved in the scrutiny process, not specifically the committee, so that's something we need to clarify.
I mean, our initial conversations will be with parliamentary officials, which is why I can't indicate a timetable, but I wouldn't be hugely surprised if that does then become a committee
consideration. Yeah, I mean, that's the logic of it.
The logic of it, but we're a little bit away from being able to give a precise timetable for that, yeah.
But as soon as you're in a position to do that, you would indicate to the committee, right? That would be welcome. Kate Forbes has a question.
Just picking up on the community right to buy, when will the right to buy provisions be consulted on? And more importantly, what kind of support is going to be given to communities who would like to exercise their new rights?
Well, there's a number of regulations needing to be made prior to commencement of the parts detailing community right to buy. And we're currently giving consideration as to the precise timings of this. For new members particularly, when we pass the legislation, it doesn't necessarily trigger the implementation. The implementation can sometimes take a good bit longer and often is driven by subordinate legislation. So that process is still ongoing. We will, at the same time, however, need to implement the right to buy regulations under the Community Empowerment Act. And I think we need to remember that there's also the Community Empowerment Act at play now, not just the Land Reform Act. Some consultations, the secondary legislation consultations on relating to Part 3A of the Land Reform Scotland Act, and that's the business about abandoned, neglected land, etc. And the proposals relating to the Crofton Community Right to Buy, and these are coming out of the 2003 Act. Those two consultations closed on the 20th of June. Again, members would be forgiven for having overlooked some of these things. We're currently collating and analysing the responses. And considering the precise timings for the implementation of the new Community Right to Buy brought in by the Community Empowerment Act as well, we will be providing guidance and support to communities. There's refreshed guidance gone out already. We are conscious, and I've had it raised with me directly by those involved in various communities, that there is a big issue about resourcing capacity in communities to take these issues forward. And it is something that we are looking at quite closely because the demands of right to buy, particularly in areas where there aren't already existing community trusts or development trusts, can be quite difficult for people to take on.
Dave Stewart's got a very brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, the SNP manifesto talked about setting up Land Scotland, a new land agency. What's the timetable for setting this up, and what will the impact be on organisations like SNH, SEPA and the Crown Estates?
Well, Land Scotland is effectively about government land holdings. It was one of the things I asked a question about very early on when I was first given this job, because my immediate response was to go look at the manifesto and then I went to query it. I think I'm right in saying that will be taken forward by the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and is therefore likely to be going through the Rural Economy Committee. Am I right, Keith?
Yes.
I think
because the largest public land holding in Scotland is the National Forest Estate, 640,000 hectares, and the context of Land Scotland being proposed was partly in the context of the government's intentions in relation to forestry, then it's going to be taken forward by Mr. Ewing.
I mean, effectively, that's a shorthand for saying that I've not had any immediate discussions with the various agencies about this, because it's not... That's not to say that I won't have to, because it is one of those areas that will have some impact on my portfolio. But because, you know, I'm not the primary driver and I'm not at this stage in conversations about it. And it will have a very separate remit from the Land Commission. I think there might have been the danger of a confusion between the two, but they are not at all the same. The Land Commission is about law, policies and practices. The Land Scotland is a new land agency, which is about management, and that's a different, it's a different thing entirely.
Thank you. Talking about possible confusion, Cabinet Secretary, there's a letter going to the Equal Opportunities and Human Rights Committee, which meets on Thursday, from Angela Constance, the Cabinet Secretary for Community, Social Security and Equalities, in which it's indicated that oversight of land rights and the human rights dimension for land reform will lie with Mr. Ewing. Is that wrong, or is it right?
I haven't seen that letter. Land reform is in this portfolio. This, yeah. I am the Cabinet Secretary for Land Reform, as is evidenced in the title.
Yeah, it's just that this is the human rights dimension. Perhaps you could
well,
write
I
back
think,
to some
yes,
clarity
I mean,
around
I,
that.
I mean, most aspects of every portfolio will impinge on other portfolios. There isn't a, there are no hard lines between portfolios. So, you know, when it comes to, for example, the Scottish National Action Plan in human rights, it will refer to human rights to, for you know, example amongst other things, right to housing, right to you know, right to be able to have employment, and land rights. Typically, in a global sense, are very much strongly part and part of that human rights picture, and you know, I can talk a little bit about that, because when I was previous Justice Minister, I was doing the Scottish National Action Plan. But the human rights aspect of it may lie with Angela Constance's portfolio. The actual policy in respect of land reform in Scotland is in this portfolio.
Okay.
I think, you know, there will be blurred and fuzzy lines between all portfolios, and we just have to work through these issues as and when they arise.
Okay. It's really just a question of who would lead on this.
Well, on land reform, yes, me.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you. Mark Roscoe has a question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. There was a commitment given in the previous session to launch a consultation into a tax on derelict or vacant land. I just wanted to know where that consultation was at the moment.
We
don't have information about that. Can we write to you about that?
Yep.
That's probably because it will be taking place in a different portfolio, and
yep.
That okay. we'll get you a separate note about
okay.
that. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Okay. Land use strategy and the physical environment. Alexander Burnett.
Really, just to ask. Obviously, the land use strategy. Yeah, potentially groundbreaking approach, and hopefully very positive. There wasn't any budget committed by the Scottish Government to its proper implementation. Could the Cabinet Secretary just confirm the full implementation of Scotland's land use strategy is a political priority and will be fully funded?
I think land use strategy was mentioned in the government's manifesto pre-election. It is important. I've already referred to the land use strategy. We're taking that forward. Will it be always and everywhere fully funded by central government alone? I think there are a number of agencies and ways in which aspects of that strategy will be taken forward in terms of financial resources. It's not something to which we've allocated a large chunk of money, which will then be spent specifically, because a lot of the actions that you're looking at will be funded in different ways and by different streams.
Okay, thanks. There will be some additional questions around this. We'll write to you on,
okay.
As we've got a lot of ground to cover, Cabinet Secretary. I want to move on and look at the marine environment, and in particular MPAs, and Kate Forbes is going to lead in this part.
So, yeah, just
two questions. The first is the Small Isles MPA, which was postponed in the last session. So when will the MPA management measures be published for consultation for the Small Isles?
August.
Great.
And we intend it to last 8 weeks. So you can be looking out for it in the summer. We anticipate that SIs will be laid in Parliament in time for measures to take effect on the 1st of January 2017.
Okay. And in terms of the timetable for the second batch of MPAs and SAC management measures, how are you going to ensure that all stakeholders are engaged in and part of the process?
Well, we're in constant discussion with stakeholders about all of these issues, all related issues. But there's a formal consultation planned for winter 2016, so that'll be a little bit further down the road. The magnitude of the response to the consultation will then determine the subsequent parliamentary timetable for statutory instruments. But we anticipate that taking place ahead of summer recess 2017 or just after. So the committee will have relevant SIs from the Small Isles consultation by January. If they're to take effect in January, you'll probably get them before Christmas. And then again, you work back from the timetable for summer recess.
One last one. In terms of MPAs already in place, how are we monitoring the success or otherwise of them, particularly the impact on livelihoods?
We don't have any initial findings at the moment. It's all a bit too recent because the MPAs have really only taken effect this year, and obviously official fisheries data takes a while to feed through for analysis. There will be socioeconomic monitoring. That is something that we look at. It's going to look at two different areas, how the fishing industry is changing its activities in response to the MPAs, and what the impact is on landings as a result. And that means also looking at incomes and employment in coastal areas. So we're currently gathering evidence on that, and we hope to be able to report on that by the end of the year. But in a sense, this is all an ongoing process. So, you know, you're consulting, you're introducing, you're monitoring, you're looking at this, and it's all a kind of rolling caravan, really, which is constantly under assessment. And each one kind of informs how we handle the next one.
Unfair question because it predates your time, but in the last Parliament, or towards the end of the last Parliament, the predecessor committee certainly took evidence that indicated there had been a degree of confusion from the discussions that had taken place between Marine Scotland and some of the stakeholders over MPAs, whereby people came out of the room feeling that points they had made had been accepted, taken on board, and then it turned out in the final proposals they weren't. Now, accepting there may be wishful thinking at work here, are you confident, Cabinet Secretary, that the way in which dialogue will take place and consultation will take place going forward will avoid situations like that?
I would very much hope that situations like that can be avoided. I suppose one can never rule it out when humans are involved, and you know, people often kind of hear what they want to hear on both sides, really. One of the issues around all of this is, of course, that you know, for these designations, we are required to look at the science, not the socioeconomics. But of course, the communities that are affected by them want to look at the socioeconomics, not just the science. So there is always a bit of dynamic tension in all of this. What will be important is the analysis of the existing MPAs and the impacts that they've had. That will be important going forward for any future discussions that are had. But, you know, we are in a kind of constant dialogue on these issues and probably will continue to be so.
Okay, thank you. Finlay Carson.
Thanks,
for like me, it might be just an offshoot from this, but it just came to mind. We have an issue with electrofishing, illegal electrofishing. Does that come under this remit to the environment where there's actually a potential damage to a species? We have electrofishing of razor clams.
Can I come back to you on this specific issue?
Yeah. Right. But generally, is this committee's remit to look at protection of species in marine areas? So that would come under this remit.
This committee can look at anything that relates to, you know, species protection, environment, etc. That doesn't mean to say that there isn't another committee that will also be looking at the same issues, but perhaps from a slightly different angle.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish, to wind this up.
Thank you, Convener. I found your responses in relation to MPAs, having been on the previous Rural Affairs Committee, reassuring. I'd just like to highlight the issue of obviously looking at what fishing effort is now, but also what the environmental capacity can cope with for future generations of people who fish as well. And I'd also just like to ask you, and whether that would be for now or in writing, to give the committee some detail about the progress with the National Marine Plan and also the two pilot regional marine plans, because of the implications for the environment in relation to the whole range of marine development in a sustainable context.
Right. Not quite sure what you're asking me there.
Okay.
I mean...
I'm asking about the National Marine Plan. I suppose I should rephrase it. Is that within our brief, which I hope it is, and the pilots that flow from it, because it's environmental protection coming from the Marine Act 2010.
Yeah, I confess that we've not really looked at this in detail, and it may be that this is one that isn't entirely for us. So can we perhaps write to you just on the back of this?
That would be fine.
Right, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, I'm dealing with biodiversity, Mark Roscoe.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think when the 2020 biodiversity route map came out, you know, it was widely heralded by stakeholders. You know, it seemed to be a lot of energy behind that drive to get biodiversity much more mainstreamed across the public sector and different parts of our economy and our society. But my sense is that some of the energy has gone out of that route map. You know, the Scottish Biodiversity Committee hasn't met now for over a year. So I wanted to ask you, Cabinet Secretary, how are you going to re-energise efforts to make progress in this important area?
This is SNH are the lead agency for this. I know that we haven't gone as far and as fast as I think we would anticipated that we might have done by now. But one of the issues that arises here is, you know, sometimes the same tensions that arise in other aspects of things, where you're balancing a lot of different rights and responsibilities and trying to take people forward with you, as opposed to just simply imposing, I think is for me, quite important. We are closely monitoring progress, and SNH are key in that. There are a lot of actions and a lot of work out there taking place, I think the first 6-monthly report from SNH is due now. Has it been published?
The first 6-monthly report on the delivery of the route map has been published, and we're expecting shortly the first report of the progress to meet the HE targets. So there's a regular series of 6-monthly reporting by SNH to Scottish Government.
Yeah. I mean, just briefly, I didn't get a sense through the work of the Scottish Biodiversity Committee that there were massive tensions. I mean, what I got a sense of is that there's opportunity for great synergies, you know, between health and environment and the economy and tourism and biodiversity. I think what's been perhaps missing has been, you know, a minister chairing the committee. Mm. The minister previously chaired the committee, but there was no meetings at all last year, so it would be welcome, Cabinet Secretary, if you could, you know, consider perhaps convening the committee again and bringing stakeholders together.
Okay, I'm just being advised that there were some kind of process issues over the last year that perhaps there was a co-chairing rather than a single chair. I'm sorry, yeah. Obviously, because I've not been here.
Response to the points Mr. Roscoe's.
The brief answer is that there was ministerial oversight of what's called the RAFE Delivery Board, Rural Affairs, Food and Environment Delivery Board, which is co-chaired by Mr. Lockhead and Dr. McLeod, and biodiversity was reporting to it. So although the Scottish Biodiversity Committee hasn't met, there was ministerial oversight through the RAFE Delivery Board.
I mean, we're obviously going to have to relook at some of this now because we're in a different structure now. So, I mean, it's one of the things that I'll be considering how we move forward with that. The tensions I was referring to arise out of some of the very specific things that fall within that broader biodiversity framework, and I think the member will know what some of them might be.
Yeah, aware of some opportunities as well. But if you could write back, that would be good.
And we may have some supplementary questions around that as well to send to you. I want to deal with wildlife crime and then do a wrap of a variety of small issues. So Gail Forbes is going to weed on that. Gail Rose.
Thanks. Good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. The Pusty Review reported in November 2015 and it made 10 recommendations. And some of these would involve legislative changes to widen the range of offences which would attract an increased maximum possible fine of £40,000. What plans do the Scottish Government have to take forward the recommendations of the Wildlife Crimes Penalties Review Group? What plans do the Scottish Government have to carry out a wildlife crime prevention review and to set up a wildlife crime investigation unit? And given that we contribute to the UK unit at Livingston, would that continue if we set up one of our own?
Well, the wildlife crime investigation unit, there's already been initial discussions with Police Scotland on the issue, but we haven't yet finalised details. But it is something that is currently under active discussion. We have in mind a dedicated new unit, but obviously that's, you know, we have to have the conversation with Police Scotland because there's operational issues that would impact on them, and it would be a small unit. I don't want to mislead people into thinking that there's going to be a great new office building with hundreds of police officers in there and all the rest of it. That what's anticipated is a small unit. And it will be very much part of Police Scotland, which I think is important. We expect to be able to announce specific details on that come the autumn, certainly after the summer recess. In respect of the Wildlife Crime Penalties Review Group, we've obviously made a pretty comprehensive response in respect of the recommendations, which were wide-ranging, and some of the recommendations, including the one about penalties, would require primary legislation. We have yet to identify an appropriate vehicle for that. So the expectation is at some point in the lifetime of this Parliament there will be legislation around these issues, but it's getting it into the right bill will be important. There are other recommendations, various other bits and pieces about alternative penalties, impact statements and all the rest of it. We will need to work through all of those in discussion with other parties in order to establish the next steps and whether or not some of these things would also require legislation or could be done in a different way. What else did you ask me about? Sorry, that's the review group and penalties, the investigation unit, the Livingston unit. Well, I mean, obviously that's a conversation that we would have to have once we'd set up the investigation unit. It's part and parcel of the conversation we're currently having.
The National Wildlife Crime Unit based at Livingston is of course co-funded with the UK government and performs a different function to what's envisaged as the unit in Police Scotland. It's primarily an intelligence collecting unit. As I say, it's co-funded, and at the moment the Scottish Government has committed to maintain the funding of that joint unit.
Thank you.
Yep. Apologies to members, there are some areas we're not going to cover today, but can I have a quick fire wrap up with you, Cabinet Secretary, around timings really more than anything, around a variety of things. If you can provide some answers, that'd be useful, or write back to us. The Protection for Wild Mammals Review, what's the scope of that review and the rough timetable for its completion?
We expect Lord Bonamy to report somewhere in the autumn, but of course, as you'll know, autumn can be any time from September through to November, so I can't be any more specific than that. At that point, we'd have to consider the recommendations. He's already received something like 300 written submissions, so it's quite big. I can't say, but it, from the perspective of the committee, you probably, when the review is published, you might want to have a look at it. I'm saying autumn, so perhaps you need to think about how to timetable that. You know, whether or not there ended up being legislation from that, then, you know, you'd be looking for considerably further down the line.
Okay, thank you. The Scottish Government has indicated an intention to take some action around the issue of wild animals and circuses.
Yes.
It was very much a kind of vague commitment to do it. Can you put any meat in the bones around
it's
that?
It's not a vague commitment. We are going to legislate to do it. What I can't tell you is when.
Okay. Beavers, reintroduction of, a decision is due before the end of the year.
Under active consideration by me, and I am, while I don't want to frighten the officials, I would hope we're not waiting until the very end of the year to do it.
Okay. And the consultation into a tail docking exemption for working dogs, I think, has concluded. Is there any kind of timescales around a decision on that?
None yet at the moment. Committee members will need to consider that the extensive work that's involved, the impacts on how you schedule your business, similarly for government officials, has the same impact. So we have to look at, you know, how officials manage what they have to manage and what kind of timescales they can do it in, because in some of these cases, it's the same set of officials that will be doing two or three different things. And that, just from our perspective, creates a bit of, can potentially create a logjam if we don't separate things out. The tail docking consultation, we're expecting to get a report on the analysis of the consultation responses in the autumn. And then once we've seen that, a decision will be made about what happens in the future. So again, you know, that's something that you might be looking at in terms of your committee work.
Okay, thank you. That's useful for the committee, but it's also useful for the stakeholders out there who are obviously interested in these wide and varied issues. Cabinet Secretary, can I thank you for your time today and for the assistance of your officials. As agreed earlier, the committee will now move into private session to discuss its work programme at the next meeting of the committee. As the next meeting of the committee is to be agreed during this session, details of future meetings of the committee will be published on the website and on the Twitter feed. I now close the public part of the meeting, and the committee will move into private session as agreed earlier.